This episode examines Henri Lefebvre's understanding of the relationship of man in the landscape, the relationship that ultimately produces absolute space. Man views the landscape, but he is also of it. And so in some sense, each landscape produces a different man. Landscapes have an interesting dualism, whereby we see what we conceive of the object, yet the object also shapes our conception of it. We contribute to our experience of the object, yet our experience in part emanates from the object. I will quote Lefebvre. The power of landscape does not derive from the fact that it offers itself as a spectacle, but rather from the fact that as a mirror and mirage, it presents any susceptible viewer with an image at once true and false of a creative capacity which the subject or edger is able during a moment of marvelous self-deception to claim as his own. Lefebvre argued that the most effectively appropriated spaces are those occupied by symbols. Think, for example, of gardens and parks and their relation to absolute nature, or think of religious buildings in their relation to power and wisdom. We must thus question any space manufactured with readability in mind. We must also avoid the delusion of imagining that objective knowledge of reality can really be attained by a means of graphic representation such as plan drawings. Lefebvre was not denying the existence of dualisms, for example, straight versus curved, concentricity versus grids, formal versus informal. Rather, he was really contending that we cannot reduce spaces into these dualisms without tearing their souls, the seed that carries the uniqueness of each space. Any attempt to reduce a space into the basic dualisms kills our ability to really understand it. The dualisms are materials that under varying compositions produce varying projects. Indeed, a support pillar might carry the same material compositions as a medical stone. But our fascination with one and not the other speaks of something beyond the formal distinctions. Another example. A playfield may be constituted by the same formal materials as a grazing plot, but the production of the former as a social space relates to the pleasures of childhood play, while the latter relates to a shepherd guiding and guarding his flock. This discussion about the relationship of man and the landscape is a great background to understanding absolute space. So, how do you actually explain the relationship of man and his space? Lefebvre noted that to be a man or woman of a certain space is to internalize the codes that govern the existence of that social space. Consequently, to understand a space is to understand the acts or gestures, past and present, that have produced it. Think, for example, of politeness, courtesy, affection, trading activities, among others. The solidification of these gestures within religious and political contexts produces absolute space. Tombs and funeral spaces are examples of absolute space in their duality of expressing formal beauty while at the same time holding terrifying content. Absolute space is in this sense a space where death has absolute power over the living. Sometimes absolute space assumes meanings addressed not to the intellect but to the body. Meanings that are conveyed by threats, by sanctions, by a continual test of the emotions. This space is lived rather than conceived, and it is a representation of space rather than a representation of space. Lefebvre argues that absolute space has dimensions. Of course, not like those of abstract or Euclidean space. Absolute space may be said to be located nowhere and as a strictly symbolic existence. The space of a sanctuary, for example, is an absolute space, holy space. In trying to decipher complex spaces, there is often a tendency by administrators to seek assistance from science to create tools of formal knowledge that eliminate contradictions. The consequence of this is a fatal compromise of time and meaning and of lived experience. Lefebvre saw art as a tool that on one hand imitates nature, while on the other hand it seeks to separate sensual delight from suffering, and in a sense to side with joy. For example, the idea of a scenery offers a pictorial view of large tracts of natural areas, a space to be appreciated as a work of art, with pleasure and delight as the end goal. But forests and caves are also spaces of fear and harm, the dangers of the unknown. They are absolute spaces. This is all lost when all the reality of how we experience space is replaced by a fetishized abstract image. Here is a quote from Lefebvre. Urban space appears in two lights. It is replete with places which are holy or doomed, devoted to the male principle or the female, rich in families or phantasmagorias. On the other hand, it is rational, state-dominated and bureaucratic. It is momentarily degraded and obscured by traffic of every kind, including the traffic of information. Although the space of our lived reality may look like pieces jumbled together when one tries to rationalize your experiences, it is still meaningful to you. But in the absence of absolute space linked to daily experience, the phallic comes in as a signifier.